I was born in Western Africa. My father, he was a well-known Nigerian engineer, businessman, philanthropist, art collector, just jack of all trades. And because of his success in business and engineering, I was born into wealth. So essentially born with a silver spoon in my mouth. You know, we traveled the world. We had nannies, cars, drivers. We went to the best private school in Nigeria. We didn't live in a house. We lived on the compound. I mean, we just had it all. One of my dad's most valuable assets is at the time was called the Lagoon Development Project. It's now known as Banana Island. Another nickname for it is Billionaire's Island because a bunch of billionaires live on it. And in 1987, my dad had invested millions and millions and millions of dollars in all of his assets. He pretty much poured everything into it. And the Nigerian government decided in 1987, you can't have this anymore. And they stripped it from him. And my father died mysteriously days later. And when my father died, we went from rich, having absolutely everything, to poor. Like, literally not a nickel to our name. And my mom, being American, I tell people all the time my mom's story is a real coming to America story. She and my dad met at the Metropolitan Museum of Natural History. They got married 5 months later. And then my mom was whisked off to Africa, where she just was immersed in this royal, rich life. So my mom was like, there's no way I'm raising my kids here in Africa. So we permanently relocated to the Bronx. And that's where I grew up, you know, and you know, just, it was the Bronx, you know. And one thing that my mom would do, she had always been into the arts. As I said, she met my dad at an art gallery at a museum. And because she was into the arts, she would expose my brother and I to the arts. And the arts wasn't just like artwork, it was writing, it was music, it was film. She was really big into it. And my mom was a creative writer, so she would make me and my brother write so much. She would make us pick articles out the New York Times and write reports on those articles. And I remember hating it, but she was just trying to build this foundation for us as writers because she knew how important it was. So fast forward, as I got older, I began to get, you know, crazy and rambunctious. And in the late 80s and in the early 90s, hip hop and rap culture, that began to blossom and blow up. And because I didn't have a father, I was looking for a father, and I found my father in hip hop. You know, so when I would hear rappers talking about, you know, punching people in the face and disrespect you, that's what I wanted to do. When I would hear rappers talk about hooking up with girls and being a player, that's what I wanted to do. When I would hear about, you know, selling drugs and hustling to get money, that's what I wanted to do. And essentially, that's what I ended up doing. I started out stealing from my mom. That progressed to stealing from local stores, that progressed to getting jobs and just figuring out different ways to steal from those jobs. And then that progressed to selling drugs, and that progressed to running high level scams. And by the time I was 19, I had made so much money illegally that I was funneling it through a record company that I had started called Eighth Wonder Records. And yeah, I mean, went to DeWitt Clinton High School. I remember being in high school and I had this sneaker scam where I was selling sneakers from a sneaker store. I worked at the sneaker store, so instead of charging people on the credit card, I would tell them, just give me $50 and I'll get you sneakers from the store. And so I was selling Jordans for like $50, $75. I mean, but you know, it is what it is. That was my life back then. But I love the Bronx, man. The Bronx gave me my grit. It gave me my street smarts, and I think it prepared me, unbeknownst to me at the time, it was preparing me for my future in special operations, because there were so many things that I took from growing up in the hard environment of the Bronx that really prepared me for a lot of the hard, crazy environments I operated in different parts of the world.
In your book, Transformed, you kind of talk about, you know, overcoming all of those odds to become a Navy SEAL.
Yeah.
And you know, the rare small fraction of African-American men who hold that position or have held that position. So if you could talk to me about what you think is the reason for that.
Yeah, it's interesting because it's less than 1% of Navy SEALs are African-American at a given time. And I think I was like around the 50th in the history of the SEAL teams that started in 1962. I think there's a few reasons for it. One, I think it's exposure. Information, withholding information has the potential to do great harm to communities. And growing up in the Bronx, there's a lot of information, in my opinion, that's withheld from minority communities.
Still, I
agree with you 100%, still. And it was just clear because I never saw billboards about special operations or Navy SEALs or this or that. I didn't. And even after I became a SEAL, you know, I would get sent to different places to help recruit other people. And most of the places we go to are suburban areas. You know, so I think it's the withholding of information. And then also, I blame it on the education system as well.
Okay.
The public education system. And here's why I say this. When, even now, when I go speak at schools in suburban areas, or even areas like that are kind of urban in San Diego, other places around the country, I have no issue getting in and speaking and sharing, hey, here's what SEALs do, come, you know, I'm black dude, you could do it too. But I have the hardest time getting into inner city schools. I mean, I've tried going to my high school twice. No, you can't come in and speak. You can't come in and share your story. And I'm just like, why not? So I think, you know, there's something, I don't know, I don't get it. I don't get it. So I think that, you know, that access for people who do have that information is cut off. Another thing that's big is swimming. You know, being within the SEAL teams, you got to be proficient in the water. I mean, you do. I've done everything from 2 to 5 mile timed ocean swims against, and that's horrible. We've had to do evolutions in SEAL training where your hands are tied behind your back, your feet are tied together. You got to swim 50 meters, and you got to do all kinds of other stuff. You got to be able to do long breath holds. You got to be the water is an element, and that doesn't just separate, you know, African Americans from, you know, from other demographics, but it separates people in general who have just an overall fear of the water. And going back to access and information, growing up in the Bronx, where were the pools? Where I grew up, there weren't a lot of pools. I mean, there weren't, and if there was, they weren't the cleanest. I mean, from what I remember. And so, you know, if you don't have access to a place to be able to learn how to swim when you join the Navy, you're not gonna be skilled. You're not gonna be equipped to be able to go into a program like that. You're just gonna be equipped to do whatever job. Education, going back to education, to be a SEAL, be in any realm of special operations, you have to have high academic scores. And in my personal opinion, I don't think that the public education system equips you to have those academic scores that you need to go into the SEAL training. And this is one of the reasons why my mom, being a teacher in the South Bronx, was like, sit down at the table and do the extra work that I'm giving you, because I know that the public education system is not enough. You know, my mom had it in. She knew how bad it was because she was a teacher in the South Bronx, you know? And so if you're not being properly equipped with the right resources, with the right tutors, with the right books in elementary school, high school, how are you going to be able to have the academic scores to be able to go into a program that only a small percentage get accepted into? And I talk about that big in my book a lot. You know, I talk about the education system in my book because that's something that in inner cities. In my book, I intentionally did that. I think it's that, and access information. You know, knowledge is power.